back. So this is Zepha. It's my Voxel game engine I've been working on for the past 5 years. It's written in C++ and designed to be as performant as possible while also having every piece of in-game content defined in JavaScript for easy, stable modding. Creating your own engine reveals a lot of challenges that you usually don't have to think about as a game developer. Even something as simple as telling the GPU to draw a triangle becomes an ordeal when working with raw Vulkan. But there are also some higher level problems that I'd have had to deal with even if I was using a pre-made engine. Problems like, how do I render 3 kilometers of terrain without melting my GPU into molten slurry? This is part one of a 3-part series where I'm going to answer this question and talk about how I made my engine render as fast as functionally possible. So let's get into it. Voxel worlds like this one are made up of an infinite grid of blocks, which form the terrain, structures, and environments of the world. Computers don't do so well with the concept of infinity, so most Voxel games divide this grid up into fixed-size chunks and only load and render the chunks near the player. These chunks are then converted into meshes, which are the geometry that the computer can render to the screen. Meshes are composed of individual points called vertices, sequences of which define rectangles that we call quads. These vertices define the position and size of the quads, and also store the actual data for the mesh, like the texture and luminance. When approaching meshing a scene like this for the first time, your intuition might be to create a mesh for every single block in the scene, and then render them all in order. But anyone who's tried this will recognize immediately that this is a very bad idea. Rendering is done by the GPU, and it's really fast at it, but telling the GPU what to render is handled by the CPU. If you have a ton of small meshes, the CPU can't keep up, and the GPU will spend most of its time just waiting for new meshes to draw. For this reason, it's important to get as much geometry into a single mesh as possible, so that we render less meshes overall and give the GPU more work to do in between our draw commands. So instead of creating a mesh for every block, we optimize by only creating one mesh per chunk, which holds the geometry of all the blocks within it. This does have the consequence of requiring more work to update a block in the world, as we need to regenerate the entire chunk to visually change it, but modern computers are really fast, and this extra bit of effort is nothing compared to the time that we save on draw calls. The most naive way to convert a chunk into a mesh is to just take every block in the chunk, create a quad for each side of it, and shove it all into a big list. But if we do that, we end up wasting a ton of geometry rendering faces that are covered by other blocks. We want our meshes to be as efficient as possible, so that we can cram as much geometry that's actually useful into them as we can. So let's remove all the faces that are obscured by other geometry. This seemingly small optimization makes an insane difference to performance. Just by omitting faces that are covered by other blocks, we end up with only a fraction of a percent of our original quads in any given scene. This is, shockingly, as far as most Voxel games go. Minecraft, for example, which is the most famous Voxel game on the planet, just stops right here. Millions of people play this game every day on all sorts of different hardware, and some really struggle to get more than a slideshow for FPS, and it just gives up one step past the worst possible implementation. Surely we can do much, much more to optimize our meshes. An almost ubiquitous optimization in graphics programming is backface culling. It's a super simple technique that uses the direction of a quad's points to determine if it should be rendered, effectively skipping all quads that are only visible from the back. This usually works great, as most meshes are kind of shells around some imaginary object, meaning their faces are only meant to be rendered from the outside. However, for some meshes, viewing the same faces from both sides is the desired behavior. Foliage, like tall grass and flowers, for example, are made up of two quads that should be visible from either side. I fixed this a long time ago by just doubling up the quads. For each quad that needed to be visible from both sides, I just added an extra one in the same space, pointing in the opposite direction. That way, regardless of what side you looked at it from, there was always exactly one quad visible. But it turns out that was terrible for performance. Almost half the geometry in every surface chunk was taken up by tall grass, and for each instance of it, the GPU had to churn through double the geometry that it otherwise would have. The proper fix for this is actually really simple. Just turn backface culling off. The problem is that it can only be turned on or off at a mesh level, meaning that I'd have to turn off backface culling for any chunk that had a single grass blade in it, which would be a huge performance hit. Instead, I decided to make it so the mesh generator can output two meshes, one that has all of the regular backface culled quads, and another that contains foliage and other models that should have backface culling turned off. This does end up increasing the number of meshes that the engine has to render, but only on the surface terrain, so the effect is fairly minimal. And the amount of geometry it saves on makes a huge impact on the performance of the engine, so I'm pretty happy with it. This experience got me thinking though, if I could optimize the geometry of some of my meshes, I wonder if I could use another technique to optimize other meshes as well. Let's think about our typical voxel environment. In most areas, we have lots of flat floors, walls, and overhangs which span multiple blocks in each direction. With our current meshes, every block in these spans is rendered separately, even though they form one larger face. So why are we forcing the GPU to render them all as individual parts? That's the question that gave birth to the technique known as greedy meshing. Greedy meshing uses a complex algorithm to identify the best possible layout of quads to cover the most space with the least amount of geometry. Unfortunately, that takes a lot of time to compute, and is usually infeasible for real-time games. In Zephyr, I settled for a much faster, less optimal version, where the engine just grows each quad as much as possible in the positive directions until it's obstructed, and then moves on to the next. This algorithm is a lot less optimal than greedy meshing, but it runs in linear time, and still nets a huge improvement over the naive meshing we discussed before. So far though, we've only discussed blocks that render as cubes, but in Zephyr, blocks can be represented by any model. As it turns out, a block doesn't have to be a cube to benefit from greedy meshing. Even if some faces of the mesh can't be spread across multiple blocks, any face that can still be greedy meshed. For example, these grass blocks have extra faces that make them non-cubic, but that doesn't stop the top faces from being greedy meshed by the algorithm. Still though, some blocks just don't lend themselves to greedy meshing. Twigs, foliage, pebbles, and other environmental details which aren't shaped like blocks at all just can't benefit from this technique, as they have no geometry that could be merged into larger faces. To improve the performance of those, we have to look at other strategies. The most common throughline across blocks that can't be greedy meshed is that they've got lots of fine detail which is only really visible up close. What's the point of rendering a twig 200 blocks in the distance if it only displays as 3 brown pixels on the screen? For that reason, Zephyr employs a level of detail system. Blocks, either automatically or with mod configuration, generate low-resolution variants of themselves, which are swapped out for the full detail models beyond a certain distance. These variants are always full cubes, or just entirely invisible. This allows for all blocks which are far enough away to benefit from greedy meshing, and it also allows us as mod developers to disable blocks in the distance that really wouldn't be super noticeable, like tall grass, which significantly reduces the cost of rendering distant terrain. In the future, I plan to take these low-resolution models even further. At extreme distances, I want to half the resolution of blocks, making each visible block in the mesh represent a 2-block-wide segment of the world. This halving will continue to 4 blocks per cube, 8, 16, until eventually an entire chunk is represented by just one cube. This final stage would obviously be for chunks very far in the distance, though. This reduction in detail has obvious advantages in that it's rendering less polygons, and has been used in all sorts of games for a very long time. But it also has a much less obvious advantage due to modern GPU hardware. I recently watched a really compelling gamedev video about unexpected performance hangups in games, and in it he mentioned that no matter how small a face is, GPUs will still draw it in groups of 2x2 pixels. This usually doesn't matter that much, but when faces get extremely small, such as when you have really detailed terrain in the distance, each quad may only render out to 1 pixel or less on the screen. In the worst case, that means that the GPU is painting 4 pixels for every quad that only occupies one, wasting 75% of the GPU's energy. This makes it even more important that we reduce the mesh complexity for distant terrain. Simon goes into a lot more detail about this phenomenon, and I highly recommend you watch his video. I haven't implemented this LOD downscaling in the current version of the engine yet, but I do have some images of earlier tests with the technique. Other than laying out the terrain information in memory so it's possible to do this efficiently in the first place, the biggest challenge with LODs that I've yet to resolve is how to smooth over the gaps between levels of detail. I do have some ideas though, and I plan to make a more detailed video about voxel levels of detail in the future once I've had a chance to iterate on them. Reducing the complexity of distant meshes through level of detail helps a lot for render time, and it allows us to render more and more distant terrain. But as we draw the terrain out further and further, we once again brush up against the limit of how many meshes we can feasibly direct the GPU to draw in a frame. Ultimately, there's only so much we can do to optimize our data before we hit a communication breakdown. You can't get someone to read a book by texting them one word per message, and we can't get the GPU to render thousands of meshes by sending one mesh per command. To really eke out more performance from this system, we're gonna have to start speaking the GPU's language. But unfortunately, that's not something we can afford to get into today. I don't know if you've noticed, but I've been out of the game for, 7 months. It's not that I didn't want to make this video faster, it's just that I had a lot of life stuff happen to me since my last video, including my biggest university semester ever, moving homes, getting COVID, and starting my first full-time job. I started working on this script in December of last year, and I'm currently making the final revisions at the end of July. I chalk a lot of the delay up to the amount of disruptive events that have happened to me over the past several months, but I also attribute a fair amount of it to my inexperience making content in general. Only a few days ago did I realize that the script I've been making for months was actually two scripts, and then the first of the two bifurcated out into two of its own. So this video which you're watching is actually just a third of my thoughts and work that I've put in over the last half year. And while I do wish that I'd noticed the insane scope of the video and split it months earlier, I don't know. I guess you live and learn, right? I do think it's a bit of a dual-edged sword, because despite it taking forever to get this video out and release it, I now have two more in various stages of completeness just waiting to be produced and released. So really, none of that work has gone to waste, it just unfortunately happened entirely out of sequence with the way that it should've. So keep your eyes peeled for the release of those very soon, because I've put an ungodly amount of work into them, and I'm excited to share them. One of my close friends surprised me with a gift shortly after my most recent video when I hit 1,024 subscribers. It's a super cool YouTube plaque that shows the subscriber count in my favorite number system. As the gap expanded between my previous video and the present, this brainworm kept entering my mind. I kept thinking, I have to get this video out before I hit 2048, otherwise this plaque's gonna be out of date. Yeah, well, for a while, it was looking like I'd succeed, but then as if YouTube itself were conspiring against me, a surge of new people saw my channel recently, and I ended up just passing 2048 a couple days ago. So, hi everyone! I'm super glad you're here, but also, you made me fail my goal, so I expect a full apology in the comments. The YouTube landscape has changed so much since I started using the platform when I was like 9. I remember my favorite YouTubers celebrating 1,000 subscriber specials after months of creating content. In the modern day, it feels almost comically overblown to celebrate 2,000 subscribers. But genuinely, I never thought I'd be here. Seeing people care about the stuff that I'm doing fills me with a hope that I feel like I've been missing for a long time. A hope that I can achieve my goals and actually make something people care about, so thank you so, so much. I'd like to take a sec to thank all my fantastic patrons, Twitch subs, and server boosters for their incredible patience with me on making this video. I don't know what I did to deserve it, but I'm endlessly grateful. Thank you so much to Archie, Awoken Assailant, BenRob0329, Butter, Dave the Freak, FireDragon Flint, AgigaHerger Zero, Island J, Japio, Luna, Lutzi99, Maeve, Odan1, Related Title, and Therum. And an extra special sparkly thanks to Int45H and Zithia for subscribing to the Best Friends tier on Patreon. You're all just so awesome. If you'd like to support me like these wonderful people, my Patreon's linked in the description. You'll get your name in the credits, early access to the videos before they release, and access to a few secret Discord channels where I get feedback on my videos and projects before they're released. If you'd just like to chat with me or get to know some other cool game developer folks, I also have a lovely little Discord server just for that. We've built a really nice community over there that I'm really proud of, and we just hit 300 members as well. I also have a Twitch where I simulcast my game development streams every Saturday, if you're into that. But that's all from me for today. I've got enough on my plate preparing for the next video release, which hopefully should be a lot sooner than 7 months from now. I hope you learned something, and I'll see you in part 2. Bye, all!